Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our March Benedictine conversation entitled The Radical Hospitality of Benedict, Beyond Fear to Welcome. I'm really excited about this conversation this evening with Sister Kathleen, our guest. My name is Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. And so on behalf of the community and on behalf of the center, I welcome you all to this space. For those of you that have been a part of our Benedictine conversations before, you know kind of how things run. Sister Kathleen and I will be engaging in a conversation. And if at any point you have a comment or question for her, please feel free to send it in by chat. For your best viewing for this event, you might want to switch those participants that are out there might want to switch to the participant view. Gets rid of all those little boxes around there. So now I would like to introduce Sister Kathleen, our guest this evening. Sister Kathleen Atkinson is a Benedictine sister from the Annunciation Monastery in Bismarck, North Dakota, known well to the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth. Yeah. She is nationally recognized as an energetic and creative leader in hunger and homelessness education. She's developed service learning experiences for all age groups, and she's led service teams to a variety of foreign and United States locations. She's been a teacher in elementary schools, secondary ed, university level, and has also served as a director of catechesis for the Diocese of Bismarck. And in 2013, she founded an organization named Ministry on the Margins, which I'm not going to go into what that is right now because we will be hearing a lot about that this evening. So Sister Kathleen, welcome. Welcome.
Thank you. It's just great to be here. Just great.
Wonderful to have you here. I want to start with a little opening prayer. Tomorrow is the Feast of Saint Benedict. And so that's the reason that we're having our conversation on Monday evening instead of Tuesday this month. But it's so fitting that we're talking about the radical hospitality with Saint Benedict on the eve of his feast. And so I just want to start us with a little opening prayer. In honor of Benedict and all Benedictines in the world. Loving God, you who dwell in our hearts, make for us a cave there in which to hear your voice more distinctly, feel your care more tenderly, understand your will more clearly, and come to know your presence at every moment of our lives with new clarity, new courage, with new faith and new urgency. Enable us to grow in the Benedictine spirit in ways that make us compassionate co-creators of a world in process, creative keepers of the human community, loving listeners to the heartbeat of the world, caring sisters and brothers to its wounded, and bringers of peace to a world in distress. Let us sink into your word, let it nourish us to life, let it lead us beyond the burdens of the day, so that we may become the people you desire us to be. Give us hearts where all may enter in, ears to hear your call, hands to do your will, voices to sing your praise, and soul enough to recognize you in everything we do. This we ask through the intercession of all the faithful monastics who have gone before us, and through the grace of the living God. Amen.
Amen.
So to begin our conversation, I'm going to show you all a little video. Sister Kathleen was recently named in North Dakota as one of four women, remarkable women. And so I just want to show this just came out the other day, right, Sister Kathleen?
It did, yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's called the Remarkable Women series. And so it's just a 3-minute video that I want to start us with.
There are some aspects to her life that you may not have known before. Adrian Oglesby met with Sister Kathleen to learn more about what makes her such a remarkable woman.
A remarkable woman is someone who knows herself, deeply rooted in all of her strengths and all of her weaknesses, and can hold them lightly. Not taking yourself too seriously, but even more importantly than that, taking yourself with the worthiness that you have.
From being active with those on the street, ministering in the state penitentiary, and of course, ministry on the margins, it could be said that Sister Kathleen Atkinson does not sit down, but what she stands for is truly remarkable. She shares that her love for serving has always been natural.
Service is naturally who I am because I've been so blessed, and I've been involved with a family who's been about service. And so you grow up, it's what you do. You do projects, you do Girl Scouts, and it just grows into this is how it looks like when I'm an adult now.
Her biggest personal achievement is seeing people come together and form something amazing, ministry on the margins. And as she continues to serve her community the best way she can, she says she will do so with a creative and resilient mindset. She tells us when she is in lifting a hand and helping those around her, she still remains busy.
I love to connect. I love to have coffee. I love to have lunch. I love to have dinner. I love to talk to people. With that connection, I love to travel.
Well, I'm sure this will not be the last time we connect with Sister Kathleen as she continues to do remarkable things in our area. Reporting for KX News, I'm Adrian Oglesby.
Nobody can say no to a jelly bean. Well, Sister Kathleen's goals moving forward are to make our community feel connected as one and to get in touch with her life on a more spiritual level. So that is always a fantastic goal.
What a fun little video.
I kind of call it Google gone wild. It just went on.
Our town
site got them all.
Fight against breast cancer. When you see our pink trucks,
Google gone wild. Yeah. Why don't you kind of expand a little bit with some of the things you were saying in that video? Tell us a little bit about your current work with ministry on the margins. How did you get there? Why do you do this work?
Well, you know, I think the biggest gift, I hit this time and I always say, where I just had always wondered. And I thought maybe someday I'm going to try. And I simply picked up the phone and I called the chaplain at the North Dakota State Penitentiary. And I said, gal, geez, you know, do you think there's anything I can do? This would be in the men's maximum security penitentiary. And he said, yes. And I thought, oops. And there I went. And that first night, you know, you go into something that's totally unknown and there's fear. And here in the penitentiary, there are 8 gates that open and close. Then you walk through and opened and closed. Mm-hmm. And each time this opened, closed, my mind thought, this is really dumb. But I kept going forward. And I was going to take care of those people. And that was really how I came in. And as I'm going further into the prison, suddenly out of one of the hallways, this guy goes, hey, Sister Kay. And it was a young man that I had taught as a third grade student when I was in that Catholic school. Mm-hmm. And I know he was challenged with drugs and alcohol, but you don't expect to find the children that you've taught in the hallway of the penitentiary. And as we went a little further, I'm walking and a guy came out that was would scare me at that time and just kind of go, oh, sister. And it was a gentleman whose dad had been a colleague of mine when I had taught at the university. As we get into the chapel, a young man bounds in and says, hey, sister, how's Shannon? And it was someone who had been in high school with my niece and had been at our family 4th of July picnics and was just very much a person in me. And still everything in me wants to go, she's so happily married. You know, her husband is a hockey coach. Keep this distance, because my mind is getting blown that I knew these people and they were the families and they were the kids I'd known. I left that night, and that would have been November 2013, and I just sat in the prison parking lot and I cried. I cried because I knew whatever had happened had broken me open and broken me apart, and I would need to be returning to that prison. Mm-hmm. I was just there yesterday to preside the Sunday morning service, and every now and then I get teased that I'm one of the longest inmates at our gathering because I've been there almost 10 years now. But that was the first thing, and I had continued to go in thinking I was doing something impactful and kind of cool and talking to people about this new call that I was finding and what I was learning. And then James came to our group March of that year. It was blizzarding and cold like it is now. And he was wound up. And I said, well, James, what's up? And the other gentleman helped me learn that he was getting out the next week. My first thought was how exciting. And again, they taught me. They taught me that Bismarck, which is my home community, I'm very familiar. I know the people. He had never been in our city until he had been brought into the walls, shackled in a van. And he'd been there. And he had come from a little farming community and little intellectually challenged, a little socially challenged, and he was supposed to come out of those gates and enter into the city and re-enter and make his life successful. His offense was a sex offense, so he had no place to live, and he walked out, and the first thing that I did is said, well, I'll pick you up. And I picked him up and we went to McDonald's for good French fries. And we went to a thrift shop for clothing that didn't say Department of Corrections. And we got him registered and found a place where he could be safe and get food. So that's really the two prongs of ministry on the margins. I continued to talk to people about what I was doing and what I was learning. And people began to say, I've always felt drawn towards ministry like that. Or, you know, sister, my son, my nephew was or is incarcerated. I know how hard it is. 2013, we started to call it ministry on the margins, on the streets. We've been blessed. Now that we've grown to serving an average of 1,200 people a week with those same things happening, have developed right now, we're blessed again with 19 employees who are working with us, seven of which are second chance hires. So people that have been incarcerated on the streets themselves that are trying to reenter. That's the gift and the development of who we've become.
Wow. So helping people re-enter society. Who else do you serve? It can't be 1,200 a week.
We serve people who fall through the cracks,
okay,
the margins of life. And there are a lot of the transitions. It's not just prison reentry. It may be a transition from homelessness into a home, or into a job, or out of a broken relationship, or trying to work with addiction. And so there are two things that we do, and we identify there are a lot of good services, but they're just all these cracks and margins that people fall through. And then our whole emphasis, which really would be the Benedictine spirit that we live, is how do we help people to feel part of the community so that they're not on the margins? What does it mean to belong?
Mm.
What are the things that help? And so food and clothing and help with housing or maybe getting jobs or offering events that are normalizing and inviting the people who are homeless to a Christmas concert, serving ice cream. All of those things that we do as part of community. In fact, you know, when we talk about our people and we refer to them as our people, and that's catching on, it's very prominent in the city that, you know, you don't talk about those people.
Mm.
Our people is the way we refer to it, and it's, there are members in our community who maybe are homeless or are addicted or right now are incarcerated. But they can never leave that our people phrase.
Mm. Yeah. That's fascinating. I love that change of language. You know, it strikes me as you're talking that you are filling a huge hole that our government and legal system can't do. And that's that piece of belonging. Because, and that seems to me to be as important as getting a job. You know, it's all about self-worth. How is your ministry received by government, law enforcement, et cetera, churches in the community?
I think as you even saw, very seldom in those little clips and pictures did I do anything alone, except maybe those little baby pictures. But ministry on the margins, we don't talk about ourselves really as a program. I think of service and ministry in three ways, and you begin to become aware of it, reflecting. Sometimes you get really into a place, and there's a lot of nice buildings, and you build a real nice place to serve people and you put energy there, and then there's real nice programs and you have them and that's good, but we always talk about the people, and that's more of where our emphasis is. So what do the people need to help them become more part of the community? And it's very, very simple to always keep that in mind. I asked that one of the phrases that formed ministry on the margins and continues to form who I am and who we are is a profound thank you, that profound gratitude to realize that I have done nothing to deserve to be in a home or with food, living on this side of a border. I have done nothing to deserve that. So I say a thank you But the second phrase that's always forming who we are is a humble curiosity. Mm-hmm. It's saying, you know, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. I didn't know. My first lesson learned was that toilet paper wasn't covered on SNAP benefits.
Oh,
that was huge, because then you start to think, what a burden, and how do you help people to gain something and do it in a way that is respectful? And so, using my campus ministry background, we played grocery bingo. And we include all of those items that aren't covered by other programs.
Wow.
Very simple, but it's more of a movement than any fancy program.
Mm. That's pretty brilliant. Plus, it's fun.
It's fun. It's fun. Mm-hmm. One of the best compliments that I ever heard one of our people say at a coffee house, and he said to another guy, he just said, you know, this is a good place. They treat us like human beings, not homeless beings.
Mm.
And it's huge.
That is a wonderful compliment. You know, with us celebrating the Feast of Saint Benedict, I'm just kind of wondering how your background prepared you for what you're doing now. What about your life as a religious has brought you to where you are? How does it speak to you in what you're doing?
Ministry on the Margins is one of our sponsored ministries of the Annunciation Monastery. So we are Benedictine, we talk Benedictine, but there's that first word, you know, to listen.
Mm-hmm.
To listen to the people and to hear what they say they need more than me from up above or whatever piece I have. I decide what you need.
Mm-hmm.
Heartbreak, beautiful listening was one night at a food pantry. And I came and there was a little girl, and, you know, I mean, she's kind of cradling her dolly. And this was really the song that she sang to her dolly, you know, saying, don't worry, honey. Mommy's getting us food. Mommy's getting us food. Don't worry, honey. And, you know, that's a song that I never had to sing to my doll.
Right.
But in the tenderness of that little girl, to listen to what she was saying. And how do we honor the children who are the families who are there in need? That's one of our Benedictine pieces. Of course, stability is huge. Benedictines, we've placed ourselves in the midst of our people that we serve.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always been one of the ways that I understand stability. And so we make a decision as Ministry on the Margins to place ourselves in the midst of where the people are that are in need. And you always kind of look around, you think maybe we should go to this building or that. But what it does is it says to the people that we serve, we're here. The first time that I received a donation for the ministry from the prison, the card said, it was $5. It was from a man named Paul. And it just said, please use this money for someone who is getting out today. I hope there's someone there for me in 12 years when I finish my term.
Wow.
So people are often, they draw hope from that stability, I think it's so Benedictine, that says, we're going to be here in 12 years for you, Paul.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking long term. And he can trust in that.
Mm.
I think there would be a third one that's right at our door. It's really important. And it's with that belonging. And that is the Benedictine phrase, let all be received as Christ.
Mm-hmm.
With a lot of emphasis on that all. Now, in Benedict says, let all be received as Christ. In social work, in shelters, often they talk about high barrier or low barrier.
Mm-hmm.
Low barrier meaning we accept the people who are addicted or struggling with mental health or have different felonies. That's their description of the all. Sister Kathleen's description of what it means is all be received as Christ is at ministry on the margins. You can be drunk and you can be high and you can be struggling with mental health issues. You just can't be a jerk.
Mm-hmm.
It's behavior related because you not only are accepted in, but you have a responsibility to the other men and women who are there with you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so again, very Benedictine, but it's a very Benedictine way on the ground.
It sure is. That's beautiful. When we met to prepare for tonight, you were talking about this concept of an economy of abundance mindset versus an economy of scarcity. And I'm wondering if you could kind of speak to that a little bit and what that means for your work.
Yes. You know, it becomes real scary to be in a nonprofit, and you can get very caught up in how do we maintain, you know, how do we keep the heat on, how do we do that? And the economy of abundance says God would not call us to something that God does not also equip us to do.
Mm.
Here's the hard piece, though. I have to be very clear and sharp in my discernment of what it is that we're called to do. It becomes very easy to want to do everything.
Oh,
luckily I'm blessed with a board that has, I just said, hey folks, I need you to say no, and I want you to challenge me because we're going to be here long term, and we have what we need to do it, what we need to do. And the bigger question is, what is it that we really need to be about doing instead of any type of, you know, you can get into the competition with another nonprofit and, you know, you can get that territorialism. So that's the economy of abundance. The economy of abundance also says you have to live loosely. And so we're blessed here at the ministry in our space that most of our furniture is donated. Most of our food that we serve, thousands of pounds of food every week in the food pantry, is donated. And if it's got to be so loosely lived that I'm not going to say it's okay if something is stolen, but I have to keep a real sharp awareness for myself of that. Again, when I move into fear and protection, because I'm protecting my things. And you can just get caught in that always. We want nice things and we want it to be beautiful for the people who come and are part of the community. But we can't live in fear that our things take more energy than the welcoming of our people.
Hmm.
That's one of my that course, the story, the scripture story of the loaves and the fishes.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus continues to teach us, you know, you bring everyone's gifts together and you have enough to feed the people. But one of the pieces that I think is most realistic that we keep reminding ourselves of here is at the end when they say, okay, so what are we going to do with this leftover 12 baskets? You know, that's the abundance, and that is how we want to live here in our ministry and in our lives on the streets.
Hmm. Wow. You know, I'm wondering, I'm thinking as you're speaking tonight about your staff. You said you have 19 people employed there, which is fantastic. And how you must work with them to learn the paradigm, the mindset of how you need to be to be successful and to be able to really help people with this ministry. Is that something, I'm just kind of wondering how you do that? What do you do? How do you work with them? Is it a mentoring thing or?
You know, the growth in the team has been just the past few years. And, but we came primarily volunteers, and we continue to be primarily volunteers. Again, within the team, first thing that was so key is we're blessed with someone who came in bringing the structure of a fine business sense with the passion of the people.
Mm-hmm.
And my business sense is scary. I can be that one, you know, who wants to jump ahead. And so I am so appreciative, but we have a structure, you know, the Dorothy Day Worker House talks about the role for structures and systems is to help people be good.
Huh.
And so we bring in a team members that are going to help one another be good. And likewise with the volunteers, how do you keep doing that? How do you help people feel empowered and free to care, but to do it in such a way that's going to be for the safety of the people that we serve, for the long-term stability of the mm-hmm. ministry that we're involved in? But we create structures in which people can be good, can be their best.
Mm. You know, you talked a little bit earlier, when you mentioned inviting people who are homeless to a Christmas concert and giving them treats and so forth. And when you and I were preparing, you talked about this question that's been really kind of going around in my mind a lot as I've thought about tonight. But you talked about the question that every human being operates out of.
Oh, yeah.
Remember what you said? What do I want for myself and for my loved ones? So I'm wondering, as you and your staff serve these people, work with these people, accompany these people, if you could tell us some of the things you do. You said the Christmas concert. What else do you do to help them answer that question for themselves?
You know, I'm just reminded of a gentleman named Chuck who was homeless, and we call him Chuck of the truck. He lives in his pickup truck and has done that for many years. And there was a great group of people who invited Chuck to be on a panel to talk about homelessness. And then they had a representative from the Homeless Coalition and a representative from United Way. And those three, and we're going to talk about it. And Chuck didn't show up. And everybody called me and said, you know, what happened? And I said, I don't know. But the next morning, Chuck came in. And I said, hey, you know, we missed you last night. What happened? And he just looked and he said, sister, you know, I realized I would have been the only person on that panel that hadn't taken a shower today. And that really just struck me because I thought, isn't that true? And how we can try to be inclusive. And there's really a tokenism included with it. So what are the very basic things that we do at Ministry on the Margins? We have hand and foot care. And side by side, I had gone in a few weeks ago and I say, I got a pedicure and I say, my feet were so clean, I could have had them washed at the Holy Thursday service. Right? You always get it all prepped so that you can do this gesture. And there I am getting a pedicure and I'm next to Janet. And Janet is a woman who lives on the streets and struggles and has no connections. And she was thrilled to do a ladies' day with me. But next to us was Danny. And Danny's pedicure consisted of a nurse who was, he had lost six of his toes in the blizzard during Holy Week.
Oh my.
And so there we are, equal. And that's what it means to just, we're all receiving the service and the love that's very scriptural, but from such different places. So hand and foot care, we're blessed for beauty parlors and barbers that come in and do haircuts. We now have a person that comes in and offers acupuncture and craniosacral therapy. And that's been sort of reminding me of who needs something that is a stress management piece more than the people that can't afford to pay for it.
Right.
So always we're doing that. And we're always trying to remember that the people are in relationship with others. Again, a card that I was blessed to receive one Christmas with a donation said, use this for someone who's homeless. My prayer is that whatever city my son is in right now, there's a ministry on the margins taking care of him.
Oh, wow.
And so to think of a network of mothers out there caring for each other's sons who are all in desperation, which then what do we offer at the ministry in a practical sense? But we offer a mailbox, an address so that you can receive mail. And then anytime we probably have 80, 85 people that use this as their mailing address. And we have totes in a storage room where if you're homeless, you can leave your treasured possessions and not have to carry them all day. Nothing fancy, but just saying, what do we need? What do we need?
Wow. I'm sure in your work you face lots of opinions about the people that you serve, some very negative ones, even from good Catholics. I'm struck by the idea of, you know, we can go to church and hear the gospel, even the gospel of Matthew 25, right? And then we can walk outside the church and not see the poor around us or not have compassion for the poor around us. So I'm wondering if you could say a little bit more about this and how you deal with those sorts of opinions in your work.
Matthew 25. So simple. I think that's Jesus' Nike statement, you know, just do it, dang it. I was hungry, you fed me. I was homeless, you gave me shelter. What we as human beings have such a tendency to do when we move into our more defensive stances is add our own caveats in the middle. I was hungry, and you had proper identification for each person that you claimed on your food request, and you fed me. I was homeless, and you had a 600 credit score, and your felony was at least 7 years behind, and you gave me shelter.
Right.
I think we've taken it. You can't be stupid about it. You've got to be sharp. You've got to be protecting the community. But I think we've taken the message and tied it up so much coming out of our fear and added layer after layer of distinctions. If you want to see my Irish flare up, use the phrase either the worthy poor or those people, any of that that sets it apart. I think of a man that I was visiting with in prison, and Cortez's young man who had grown up on the streets of Chicago and very savvy. How he ended up in North Dakota, who knows? But there he is, we're talking, and he made this comment about church. And I thought, Tez, you're from Chicago. You've got to have been in churches. There's big churches. There's little churches. There's storefront churches. You know, don't tell me you've never been in a church. Just looked and said, sister, I've been in churches. I've been in the basement. That's where the soup cafes are. Never thought they wanted us upstairs.
Oh my.
So what's the opinion? One, however we give the message, we have to really challenge ourselves about how have we given this message that a person like Tez has to belong downstairs and can't come and worship with us.
Yeah.
And then two, what is it that we're protecting and so afraid of when we kind of add regulation after regulation after regulation onto Jesus' simple statement in Matthew 25?
Yeah, what do you think is behind that? Fear?
I do think it is fear.
Power? Greed?
And I think those things often, I mean, I react into those things when I'm most fearful. And when I'm most fearful, I like to boister up. And I can be pretty scary. People on the street will tell you, you know, my mom loves to talk about a man that we met who said, you know, you end up in any jail in the state, they say, if you're in Bismarck, go to the ministry. They'll take care of you. And then he kind of did this smirk, and he looked, and I could just see my mom going, yeah. And he said, you know what else they say? And I said, what? They say, yeah, go to the ministry, but don't get sister mad at you. Like, mom goes, yeah, you know. So how do you have that, knowing that there's boundaries, there's expectations, expectations even of people who are poor, who are addicted, who have been incarcerated. Mm-hmm. just like we do with our team and our volunteers and ourselves, we want to be our best. We want to believe they could be their best too. Mm-hmm. Everyone.
Yeah, but what else strikes me is that you're not asking things of them. You're not expecting things of them that are any different from anyone else in terms of being human.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this is what it means to live in community.
Right. Wow. I just want to remind everyone out there that if you have any comments, please go ahead and send them in, or question for Sister Kathleen. I'm sure she'd be happy to answer them for you. So you've talked about the fact that ministry on the margins, that you don't look at it as a program. And you did talk about, you know, that there are all sorts of programs out there. I wonder if you could just speak a little bit more to that, and how we shift our thinking from thinking about the poor as a program to the poor becoming part of my people.
Mm-hmm. There's so much of it is that inner work of conversion, of which, you know, again is so Benedictine, just awareness.
Right.
One of the shifts that we have is when I realize my own brokenness and my own giftedness. And then I realize every person lives within that same brokenness and giftedness.
Hmm.
When I realize a sign that I have up in my office says, don't try to think outside the box. There is no box.
Hmm.
It's just a little shift. But again, thinking outside the box does this assumption that there is one.
Hmm.
Instead, it's who are the people? I think we had talked in our visit about one of our more creative projects, maybe, is that during COVID and just prior to COVID, if I were out in the street at 3:00 in the morning,
mm-hmm.
and it was maybe 3 above last night in Bismarck,
mm-hmm.
I could have gone into Walmart and the grocery stores. And if I had a little bit of money, I could have gone into the Perkins or Danny's and got a cup of coffee. I could have gotten out of the elements. I could have gone to a gas station, used the restroom. 3:00 last night, those things are all closed now.
Oh.
That's an economic change that most cities have experienced. And
mm-hmm.
so now 3:00, we have people who are homeless, again, low barrier, or maybe they have a felony, alcohol, drugs. They maybe need to get out of a place that's not safe. And so we're not zoned and not going to open a shelter.
Mm-hmm.
But we worked with the city doing some brainstorming, and we run a coffee house. Okay? It's 10 till 8. It just happens to be 10 p.m. till 8 a.m.
Okay.
And it's open, and people could come in. There are movies. They can take a pillow and a blanket and lay on the floor. We have 2 employees at night, and we don't call them security or anything. They would be nighttime hospitality, but they're trained in de-escalation and administration of Narcan. And we had thought when we tried this as a pilot project with the city, maybe 10, 15 people a night.
Mm.
We have about 45 people every night. And we've received a thank you note from the security guard down at the parking ramp saying, I mean, I'm good. I don't want to kick people out of the parking ramp, but they can't be here. Now I have a place to go. And so the coffee house was one of those ideas that was totally outside of the box. If there is a box, it's just meeting such a need that Bismarck didn't have 3 years ago.
Wow, that's a marvelous story. I have Claire, who has written in, do you think people feel guilty when they shy away from those in need? And do you get to know the families of the people who are being released?
Yes, to both of them as much as possible. We're right now talking about the guilt thing because there's becoming more and more people. We have the panhandling at the intersections and approaching people in line at the fast food. And some of the business owners came to us and said, it's not that I mean, I care about people, but I can't have that danger. How do we protect people who want to support and want to be giving, people who are asking for money? And the truth is, the majority of the money is going to go for drugs or alcohol. You know, I have to say it because I know the people. I was driving into the interstate and I rolled down my window to someone who had a sign. I said, Daniel, hey, get off the intersection here, get down the ministry, get something to eat. He goes, yes, sister. You know, so we're trying to help people with the guilt because you want to feed them and they say, I'm hungry. But the guilt piece is right now, there are some agencies that are saying, we're working together. It's called Better Bismarck. And if you feel guilty and you want to help, send the money, text the money here. And there are professionals, so to speak, who will go out and meet the needs of the people. We have 2 days a week. We have one of the Ministry on the Margins people is out on the street doing street outreach, tracking people down, meeting them there because we don't have them coming to the office.
Hmm.
It helps people respond, keeps people safe, and we're hoping it also gets real needs met and not just helping continue the addiction.
Hmm.
I went way off and I lost the second one. Sorry about that. What was the second one?
Of her question, she said, do you get to know the families of the people?
Yes. We have a support group that is called When a Loved One is Incarcerated.
Hmm.
Okay. That doesn't say, and in that support group, we have a grandma and we have a wife, and there's a wonderful devotional book that they use that takes devotions like when you read it in the news.
Hmm.
Imagine what it's like in some of the stories that people talk about. How we also do a program that we're involved in that would be children of the incarcerated. 1 out of 27 children in our school system have a parent in jail or prison.
Wow.
So, you know, to help the children because they may have seen their mom or dad be handcuffed and taken away and they're scared. They have a right to know that mom and dad are safe.
Right.
So we do a lot of work. We also use restorative justice as an approach that would be relationship rather than punishment oriented.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. There's a couple of other comments that have come in. One must be from a person in Bismarck. They say, Sister Kathleen has been a blessing to our community here in Bismarck. Her compassion and persistence to keep moving forward to help those most in need is inspiring. Thank you, sister. And you know, I've been thinking as we've taught, as we're talking and kind of breaking open more and more about what you do there, that you're teaching and showing compassion within the whole community, not just the people you serve. Everyone is learning. Sister Lois says, Kathleen, I'm so touched by your ministry, which is so full of the Spirit of Jesus. Thank you for living the gospel with such beautiful love, compassion, and creative courage. I am so proud of you and deeply grateful to you. Blessings deep and wide be yours, from Sister Lois. Susan wants to know where we can contact you to help with your ministry with donations. So I'll just let everybody out there know that I'll send out an email tomorrow with, website and so forth. And so they can contact you through there. Is that correct?
Oh, absolutely. Our website, Facebook. Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. You know, we're getting close to our time. This hour has flown. They do all the time. And I'm thinking about you now, you personally. And you just radiate joy and deep love for what you do. But I know that you also must face some difficult and stressful situations at times. So I'm wondering where you find your joy. How do you sustain yourself? How do you keep that smile on your face?
Well, I have a rather warped sense of humor. I do it. There are two things that are very key for me.
Okay.
One is, I think I said it in that tape, I do hold myself very with great gratitude, but very lightly. I laugh. I can be in the office and just laugh, and people know it's okay. And I want to bring that to the people that I'm with, because they need that laughter. I am so blessed that I live in a good world, and I just want them to experience goodness for a moment. So that is important. The other thing is, you may not believe this, but I cherish silence. That's my monastic heart. I've always been rather contemplative, and I just need that silence, and that's very important to me. The balance of those two, a laughter and silence, maintain me.
And a little bit of your Irish heritage, probably.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Yeah, that's it.
Sister Kathleen, this has been a delight. I'm wondering what words you'd like to leave us with, what thought, what would you like us to take away tonight?
To believe, and even for my, you know, not to be afraid. I talked about the story of what's happened with ministry on the margins, just flown, because I took a risk and I picked up a phone and I made a phone call and I found out that I wasn't afraid. I wasn't afraid of the people, that they weren't an other, they were our people. Not to be afraid to take seriously the, not only invitation, but the command of Jesus to feed the hungry, to shelter the poor, to visit the prisoners, to care for the dying. To take the word of Jesus seriously, because one That's where your power is in Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
But not to be afraid to live the passion, which we're in Lent. Again, you think of the word passion, the passion of Christ, and passionate living. It's all so close.
Mm.
So that's what I want to leave, is just to believe in the God that's calling and urging and pushing forward and is going to stay and delight into that.
Thank you for that. I will walk away with that. I just have to read this one last comment because it's making me smile. Talking about laughter, she says, I love the sign on your shelf that shows that sense of humor. So right behind Sister Kathleen, it says, I can't adult today. That's wonderful. Sister Kathleen, thank you so much. Thank you very much. Renee says she welcomes all as they are, always.
Renee's a gift woman.
Oh, that's servant leadership, yes. Thank you for your time this evening, for this beautiful conversation. I learned so much from you. Thank you. And blessings on your ministry. Blessings as we move toward Easter and resurrection. Yeah. And just thank you so much. And thank you all out there for being with us tonight. On behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica, on behalf of your community, Sister Kathleen, and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, we wish you all a blessed evening and these fruitful last days of Lent as we move toward Holy Week. Thank you so much.
It's been an absolute sacred privilege. Thanks, Dawn, and everyone who's with us.
Wonderful. Good night.
Good night.